That was a bad clap.
You're a bad clap.
That's not allowed.
This Week in Gear is presented by Flipboard.
Medium format cameras are the pinnacle of digital photography, rendering the highest resolution, truest to life images possible. I gathered and tested the Hasselblad X1D II, the FujiFilm GFX 100, and the Phase One IQ4 150 to discover what, if any, practical applications each camera offers. The three cameras represent three very different price points and three very different consumers.
So what would you take first to shoot with?
So I've only been playing with the so I guess we should maybe like run down what
these
cameras
are. Yeah, let's talk about the cameras first.
All right, so this is the all-new Hasselblad X1D II. It's a consumer-facing camera, which I might not be able to say about the other two. It's for someone who kind of wants a premium shooting experience that's like, you know, similar to a Leica rangefinder, but a little bit more modern. It's got autofocus. It's got a big medium format sensor, which is going to give you kind of a distinct look, and also 50 megapixels, which is you can't really say about a Leica right now.
Neither the lenses nor the sensor are stabilized, though.
No.
However, the price on it's quite achievable, though. All things considered,
I mean, yeah, you know, we're talking relative, but yeah, you know, it's not stratospheric. A body and lens will come in at less than $10,000, which is less expensive than the X1D version 1. Yeah. The design is great. The kind of metal shaping is awesome. The screen on the back is bigger. You get a way nicer
UI. Beautiful OLED screen.
It's like thoughtful. And you know, you pick this thing up and it feels like you may have spent $10,000 pretty well. It doesn't hurt that the images that come off of it are really, really gorgeous.
That's good to know. All right, so let's move on to the Fuji GFX 100.
The astute viewer would notice that the 100 corresponds to the resolution, though it's actually 102 megapixels. But you've got the same general like sensor dimensions physically as the Hasselblad and Fuji's other lower resolution medium format cameras that have 50 megapixels. This has 102 crammed into the same area. So you get a crazy, crazy resolution. You've got things like two batteries in the grip. You've got a vertical grip. You've got a tilting screen. You've got sensor stabilization, which is a first for medium format cameras, and kind of a big deal when it comes to daily using this thing. It's great for everything the medium format has been good at. Landscapes, architecture, you know, portraiture. This actually like becomes a functional portrait camera because of the stabilization, because of the kind of general resolution. The autofocus is pretty good, definitely good enough for that kind of stuff. And it's weather sealed. That's the other thing I forgot to mention about this camera.
Like, it's weather sealed.
This is not weather sealed. This is kind of sort of weather sealed. This is like, you could have it in the rain and not be completely terrified.
That makes a really big difference.
Yeah.
Especially in the way people shoot nowadays.
Exactly. You know, you can take, we did a story a couple years ago about medium format kind of getting out of the studio and being out in the field. And to some degree, you know, that was true, and the cameras are more durable than they were before, certainly. Yeah. But this is the first one where it's kind of like really, really durable. Like, that's a daily driver.
So the price on the Fuji?
Price on the Fuji is about $10,000 for the body. The lenses are pretty affordable. This one is a great kit lens, and it's only gonna run you $1,500.
So let's talk about the this Mac Daddy here.
Yeah, so this is the Phase One IQ4. Mm-hmm. It's 150 megapixels. It's got a bigger sensor, even like within the realm of medium format, it's got a bigger sensor than these two. It's the like logical extreme of cameras as they exist right now. Everything's interchangeable, it's all modular. You know, it's a ground glass optical viewfinder, which is hilarious.
Okay, so the optical viewfinder, this allows you top-down view as well,
too. Yeah, you can do, I mean, well, we don't have the mirror's not up yet, but once it actually is, you know, you're seeing a real life picture in glass. They sell a top down viewfinder for it. It'll tether over Ethernet, which means you can run it down a ski slope. There's no practical distance limitation for Ethernet. It'll go a little slower. The key is that they kind of built a version of Capture One of their photo software into the back itself. So it'll render stuff. The previews that you get are like you rendered using the same software that you'll eventually edit in.
That doesn't mean you can't do on-camera editing, can you?
You can't really do on-camera editing. Okay, you can apply styles, but the cool thing is it allows you to sync stuff that you've tethered and stuff that you've shot just onto the card. You can shoot to XQD cards, which are fast as hell. You can shoot to SD cards as a backup. It solves a ton of problems that like the smallest portion of the photographic community has. Like, you know, we were just doing this shoot and, or, you know, we're filming this and the battery ran out on the back. And I ran to go grab one, popped open the battery door, and it's got a little tiny internal battery inside the back so that you can swap out the batteries without the camera being, without needing to turn the camera off.
Oh, you can hot swap batteries?
It's got hot swap, which is like, it doesn't need to exist. Huh. You can turn it back on. It's things like that that just take like the tiniest little edge off of a lot of kind of pro photography needs.
People are taking these more and more out of the studio
than
ever before because
they
become a lot more reliable.
If you can control the scene, if things aren't moving too much, this, when it hits, is the best image quality of any camera on earth, to my mind. It's made for pro photographers in every single sense of the word. This thing is like, I'll nerd out about it for days.
This camera,
yeah.
We're talking several orders of magnitude more than the
Fuji. Oh yeah, no, I
so
mean
the body
like,
on the Phase One is.
At this point in the program, you're like, oh, of course you would just get the Phase One. Why would you even consider the other two?
That's what
and then, so, you know, if you took this Hasselblad and this lens for the Hasselblad, you're at about, you know, $15,000.
Yep.
If you took this lens for the Fuji, you're at about 17 and a half.
Yeah, I'll pick up.
If you took this lens and the body, you're at about $27,000. $27,000 of stuff here. And you're pretty much halfway to buying this camera. It's $52,000. It's a well-optioned BMW. It's a down payment on a house. It's so many things that aren't a camera.
Well, the thing is, the camera itself is like $50,000, and this lens is a couple grand, right?
The lens, you know, everything seems reasonable when compared to a $50,000 camera. The lenses are, you know, $2,000 to $5,000. And they're phenomenal, but, you know, they're expensive. So the question is then, who is paying $52,000 for a camera? If you're a pro freelance photographer who's regularly doing commercial work, hell yeah. Buy it every day of the week. Everything will look good.
So, okay, so just rewind here. A camera that is affordable for a well-optioned personal lifestyle.
Yeah.
A camera that is professional, but starting to push up against the budget, but potentially achievable as an individual.
Yeah.
A camera that requires a corporate allocation.
Yeah, exactly.
Of budget.
This is like,
acquire. Yeah.
You know, GDP expenditure and like credit card debt. They're really the upper echelon of cameras. These are three really excellent examples of like
where medium format is today.
Where cameras are today. I mean, like,
oh, that's good. That's a good point.
You know, you've got really, really high end mirrorless or really high end DSLR kind of full frame cameras, and they're great. And they do really, really good work, and most of the photographic world relies on them. But these are like the pinnacle right now. Yeah. These are as nice as cameras get in terms of image quality.
Right.
You know, there's 300 combined megapixels on this table right now.
300 combined megapixels and about 90,000 combined dollars.
Yeah.
All right. We'll leave it there. Thanks, guys.
So if you're wondering what this sort of shake-weighty looking device in my hand is, this is a sous vide circulator. Sous vide circulators cook food via thermoregulating a body of water. So you have food inside of a bag and you leave it inside that water for, you know, could be 3 hours, 6 hours, 12 hours, sometimes even 24 hours. This is the Anova Pro sous vide that just came out a few months ago. The big thing with this is, other than it being enormous, is that it can regulate much more water than most sous vides, especially at a consumer level. So most sous vides are gonna be more like, you know, 15 to 20 liters of water at most. As far as realistic things you might cook with some regularity with a device like this, I could do 2 full pork shoulders at a time in it, and that might sound crazy, but what you can do with them is you can sous vide them for, you know, 6 to 12 hours, get them really, really tender, and then you can cut them up into steaks and freeze them. Right, whenever you want dinner, you can just throw them in a pan and like fry them up. So that's something you can do that's a little more realistic than a full, you know, leg of lamb or, you know, making a Boston butt or whatever it may be, those large serving dishes. Another thing to note is this is by Anova. Anova is sort of one of two of the major sous vide circulator brands, at least on the home level, the other being Chef Steps Jewel. Either an Anova or a Jewel are the way to go. They're the most reliable, they have great customer service, they have plenty of online support and like pretty strong warranty programs to boot. A typical sous vide will be anywhere from $70 to $80. Some of the nicer ones getting up into the $150 range. $399 is certainly a large upgrade from that on price perspective. But if you're going to use it for the right things, its performance certainly sort of justifies the price.
This Week in Gear is brought to you by Flipboard, where quality content from the world's best publishers and storytellers of every type is curated and discovered.
Oh my God.
What am I looking at?
The camera.
Oh, here, the camera. Oh!
Oh,
it's really heavy.
Like, camera.
Jesus, this camera's ridiculous.
Phase One XF. I've heard of Phase One.
I don't know anything about cameras, but this looks super fancy.
This thing is such a boss.
Can I take a picture?
I like this lavender shoe.
Listen to that action on the camera.
I actually don't like it, but it's a good... I would never wear something like that.
It sounds like a desert eagle of a camera.
Feels like something... Ow.
What?
What? I can count the threads, the individual fibers of the shoelace.
Holy shit. Oh, so much detail.
Is this normal for all cameras?
Ooh, yeah, texture, huh?
It's better than my iPhone, so that's always nice.
Whose bag is this? It's a nice bag.
I feel really professional. Yeah.
It looks like a professional did that, which is understandable. Just given the context, but you can see every fiber of the wool.
These are terrible photos I'm taking right now.
It focuses itself. I have to be 2 feet away.
One word. Extravagant.
I don't know, 100 megapixels? I have no idea.
150 megapixels? It's just so, it's impossible to compete with.
You asked me how many megapixels it is, and I guessed, and it says right on the camera.
What do megapixels do?
Oh, God. Yeah, I look how I feel about this camera.
So if you had to guess how much this camera costs, what would you say?
I don't know, $2,000?
10 grand.
20? 30, what?
52, this is $52,000?
$52,000.
Is in your hand right now.
Wow.
I should know this because I got the request from Henry to buy one for the office, and I believe that was immediately rejected.
Is it worth it?
I guess if you make billboards, it probably is.
If I had an extra $52,000, I would buy it. But I do not.
Is that the most expensive selfie you've ever taken?
Yeah, I still want to delete it.
All jokes aside, that was the Phase One IQ4 150. It is an absolute monster of a camera. This thing is gonna cost $52,000. You know, the price of like a well-equipped 3 series or a down payment on a lot of house. It's made to produce incredible images. It's got a ton of features built in around kind of the pro workflow. It talks to computers really well. You can do bracketing, you can do time lapses that are kind of beyond anything else you'll see in a camera. So you got 150 megapixels, huge medium format sensor. In terms of like a normal camera size, this is a full frame Nikon Z7. It's big, it's like expensive, it's like $3,500, and it's awesome. But this is the Phase One IQ4 sensor. But generally, the bigger the sensor, the kind of better true to life rendering, the better dynamic range, and you just get access to a lot more real estate for resolution, for bigger pixels, which will give you better low light performance. The downside is that this thing is gonna be slow and it's gonna be huge. It takes about 30 seconds to turn on. The autofocus is not exactly, you know, DSLR worthy. So who should buy it and who shouldn't? Just about everybody shouldn't buy it. You know, if you're looking for a camera to like shoot the dog, shoot the kids, don't buy this. But, you know, if you're a pro photographer, you're shooting a lot of studio stuff, you're shooting a lot of landscapes, you're shooting things that aren't generally moving around a whole lot, really anything where you're gonna make your money off of these photos, it's hard to go wrong with something like this.
So what is it about watches that appeals to me? Yeah, it's funny for somebody who's been inured in watches for so many years. I don't often ask myself that because it's a foregone conclusion. And it may sound trite, but somebody assembled this by hand. Somebody, you know, in a way that we don't really do things like that anymore. And there's nothing disposable about this. This is meant to last a lifetime. So there's a permanence that I think is missing from society these days. Everything is so fast and it's throwaway. So with my watches, it's something that's gonna outlast me. One of the beauties of being in New York City is that we're at IWC today, as I had business here, you can do in pretty much any boutique. You know, we're fortunate to be in New York City and to have access to this. You know, it's one thing I like to do when I get a chance or if I get a call from a boutique manager that a new piece has come in is I'll come and just take some pictures with my phone, nothing fancy, but then I post them up. It's almost incumbent upon collectors who live in a city like this to be able to share it with the people who don't have that access. So I do love it, and I try not to take it for granted. So here we have a Tourbillon Mystère. The Tourbillon was an escapement that was actually designed by Abraham Louis Breguet. At the time, they were pocket watches, and they were always worn like this, so the timekeeping could actually be affected by that. Now, this is the regulator, the heart of the watch, so with a Tourbillon escapement constantly spinning around, that's mitigating the effects of gravity on the movement so that it keeps the timekeeping more linear and more even. And knowing just the fine detail, the amount of engineering that went into creating that. I mean, I'm actually kind of just staring at it right now, and I know I should put it down because I have other stuff to do, but just look at that.
What's the most you have spent on a watch?
While I love watches at all price points and all different genres of pieces, there's one watch that I think is most closely associated with me, and that's this piece. Top Gun Big Pilot Perpetual Calendar. You know, I'd always loved the pilot's watch. I always loved the perpetual calendar movement, and I loved ceramic. So these were three things that had never been combined before. When this watch was announced at SIHH, which is the Salon International Haute Horology, for me meant they just made my watch. So the first thing I did is I shot an email to one of the dealers that I work with. He gets back to me and he says, well, there's good news and bad news. Good news, of course, they are making the watch. The bad news is it's about $38,000. You know, I'm a lot of things. Millionaire is not one of them. And as I started thinking about it, I started thinking, you know what, I could sell a couple watches here and there. Somehow I'll do this, because this is something I'm going to keep. So I wound up selling two watches. I was still short. So my mother is sort of always been complicit in this hobby of mine, and she'll lend me money under the table. I can pay her back this way. My wife doesn't see what's happening. And so she realized if she lent me the money I needed to get over the hump to buy this watch, that I owed her. So at the time I had a Mohawk, and she said, look, I'll lend you the money. You still have to pay me back under the same terms as usual, but you gotta shave that Mohawk off. What? Samson wouldn't shave his locks off for a watch. And I thought about it, and the very next day I showed up for lunch with her, and the Mohawk was gone, and she went, wrote me a check right on the spot, and next thing you know, I have this watch. So every time I look at this, I smile. And I think about the sacrifices I made, and I think about my mother. So I could think of worse associations to have. Harry, how you doing? Let me see that watch. Give me bring that guy. You know I love that thing. Look at this. Solid gold. Speedmaster Professional. This is a fuck you watch. You know what I'm saying? So the whole point of Red Bar was that it was about a desire to learn more, about a desire to connect more with the art of horology. You know, to be able to envision a mechanical movement that's going to keep accurate time is as much an art as it is a science. So really what we're trying to do is get more people involved who are actually gonna, you know, grow into collectors. There's nothing I love more than seeing someone who maybe joined up a year ago had one watch and really thought they knew what they liked, and then to see how they've evolved as a collector, as their knowledge has grown and their exposure to other timepieces.
So what is it about watches that appeals to me? I don't know if that answers it or not. I mean, honestly, it's something that I just love. It's just in me. It's a part of us. You know, I'll check my watch 10 times and maybe two of those times I actually knew what time it was. Every other time, I'm just looking at the watch because it makes me happy.